I taught my very first class in Chicago in 1994, and I was ill-prepared and scared to death. And I talked to some professors about it, and they said, get organized. So I put together this detailed syllabus. I had overheads with everything that you could possibly imagine, all the facts and the previews and overviews about what I was going to do. Everybody knew what had happened, what was happening, and where I was going. And so students came to class, and they took notes, and they nodded their heads. And so I was eager to see my evaluations at the end of this entire semester. And for the most part, the entire class was on board. They were unanimous in how they felt about me. One of the evaluations said, Mark Pitzer is a fantastic teacher. Just like Milli Vanilli are fantastic singers. In 1994, this is a direct hit to the solar plexus, and when I finally sobered up, I came up with a strategy, a two-part strategy. Strategy number one is that I snuck into the classrooms of the best teachers on campus. These guys that students flocked to, and it was clear, very clear, that these professors were all master storytellers. Part two of my strategy was two or three times a week for many years after that, I would go to the late night improv show at Chicago's Second City Improv Theater. And I listened to a young Tina Fey and a young Steve Colbert, and these guys that could hold your attention and keep you spellbound. And I couldn't do that on my best day on planet Earth, but I realized that they didn't use or need these high-tech visuals. They were on a black painted stage, and they were able to engage everybody's imagination. So I borrowed what I could, stole what I could, and I sprinkled it into my lectures, and my evaluations began to percolate up out of that Milli Vanilli zone or whatever it happens to be. But the litmus test, for me at least, was my daughter, Emerson. Right there, actually. And she was sitting on my lap at the age of three, and I was teaching her about the brain. And she turned to me about halfway through, and she smiled. And she put her little angel hand over my mouth, and she said, Daddy, all of your words make me have to poop. So I realized that I was so far away from being a good teacher, I couldn't even see it. And two, I really should be brief. And this is when I turned towards my field of study, behavioral neuroscience. For centuries, scientists, psychologists have been studying how humans and animals learn and the best way of presenting those stimuli for long-term memory. And for decades, neuroscientists have been figuring out the anatomy and the physiology of the brain and how your brain physically changes as you learn. And both of these groups figured out that there are multiple circuits in the brain, multiple neural networks in the brain, multiple types of cells that learn. And as a teacher, I was using one. I was using one single circuit, the hippocampal circuit. Your hippocampus in your left hemisphere and your hippocampus in your right hemisphere. I was forcing my students in this one single circuit. I was telling this to Emerson, and she goes, hippocampus, it sounds like where hippopotamuses go to college. Hippocampus, right? And I said, brilliant, that is fantastic. She told me the same day that hummus is made up of ground up hummingbirds. I have Lewis Black living in my house. Your hippocampus. Your hippocampus is like the desk that you have at home or at school or at work. And in the morning, it is relatively clear, but there are trillions of stimuli streaming in every single day from the climate to the news updates, to emails, to conversations that you have, to random facts. Like my son Cole told me that there are 3 golf balls on the moon. So all of these fill up But it didn't evolve to continue to fill up, and instead, at night, when you sleep, during slow wave sleep and REM sleep, this information on your hippocampus, in your hippocampus, on your desk, is moved. And most of it is moved into the trash. Some of it, however, goes into long-term storage. Some of it goes into the file cabinet of your brain, your cerebral cortex, this outer bark, this 16 billion neurons that you have in the brain. Well, as a teacher, you don't want your stuff there. You want your stuff here in the file cabinet so you can pull it out tomorrow. Your students can wrestle with it next week or next year or who knows when. So, how do I increase this probability that information will go there? It is stuff that we know. It is as this information is streaming in, it is the emotion that is added to it. All of these pieces of information are rated for how salient they are to you or to being adaptive organism. It's like a Yelp review, actually. You know, the conversations that you had about the weather or your commute, all of those landmarks along your commute that you've had 100 times. They might not get any stars at all, or maybe 1 star. But some of them are red hot 5 stars, like that email that you got about that unique financial opportunity from that Nigerian prince. Okay, so as teachers, it's how you package it, right? It's how that you flavor, how the emotion is added to it. But that has a long-term physiological effect of whether it's going there or it's going into the file cabinet, okay? From Chicago, my family moved to Iowa, and I don't know if you know this, but in Iowa, when you move there, you have to do 3 things. You have to get new license plates for your vehicle, you have to get a new driver's license, and you have to join a bowling league. I was told it's state law. And so we did. We put together this bowling league, this team that was pretty darn good. We were, you know, postdocs and young professors and whatnot, and we pretty much beat everybody, except for Bob's quality muffler and brakes. These guys, we would go head to head and they would crush us, and it just killed us for 2 reasons. One, they were, I think they're called nowadays, vintage gentlemen. They were in their 80s, pushing 80, pulling 80 probably. And number two, they were hammered. But they would pick up these balls, these 16-pound balls, and they would shuffle to the line, and they would lift them up, and their brains would click. And they would move with the precision and grace of an Olympic gymnast, and that ball would spin in a pure mathematical arc right to the pocket, and they would make strike after strike after strike, and we would cry, and we would cry, and we would cry. Why? Because of their basal ganglia and their cerebellum. Basal ganglia, yeah, you knew that. Basal ganglia in the left hemisphere. And in the right hemisphere, these large structures and circuits, as well as your cerebellum in the back of the brain. Both of these are involved in all things movement. And as you practice, the basal ganglia and the cerebellum make you better. Right? Whether it's you got a new phone, you got a new app, you're learning a Billy Joel song on the piano, you're trying to get the ketchup packet open without getting ketchup all over you, you get better and better and better. And Bob's quality muffler and brakes had been working on their motor programs since the Roosevelt administration, since the first Roosevelt administration. So as a teacher, what do? We draw. In my class, everything is on the board. I draw everything and it's in real time and everybody draws. There's nothing on the internet that they're going to get. There's nothing that I'm going to hand out to them. I'm engaging their basal ganglia and their cerebellum. A second circuit, a second strong learning circuit next to the hippocampus. Okay? Another If I were to pull out your brain, I could show you. No, I couldn't show you. If I pulled out the person's brain sitting next to you, I could show you that there is indeed a lot of real estate back here that is your visual cortex. A lot of it. And it is not just involved in your conscious awareness of faces and the color red and textures and movement and that. But also, this is the file cabinet for all things visual. Right? You know that pictures are very easy to recall. This has been known for thousands of years. This is the basis of Cicero's memory palace. Mark Twain used these visual concepts to remember his lectures as he would go through. This is how champions of memory competitions can remember the exact order of stacks of cards. 10 shuffled decks of cards by taking groups of them and transforming them into concrete visual images. And then they can remember these very effectively and efficiently. A couple of years ago, I was back in Chicago, walking down Michigan Avenue, and I ran into one of these professors that I used to steal from. I used to sneak into the back of his classroom, Dr. David Warshafter and his wife, walking down Michigan Avenue. And I had a little bit of trepidation about walking up to him because he had retired early because his memory was failing him. But nonetheless, I had to talk to him, and I walked right up, and I go, Dr. Warshafter, Mrs. Warshafter, my name is, and Dave looked up, and he goes, Mark Pitzer, and it shocked me. And he started to talk, and about halfway through, he broke, and he said, maybe you knew it, maybe you didn't, but I retired early because my memory was going. And I said, I knew that. And he said, about a year and a half later, on the north side of Chicago, I found this school. And they taught me how to transform names, ideas, dates into concrete visual images, and I remember everything. And I go, Dave, that is fantastic. That's remarkable. He goes, I remembered your name because months back, I imagined this magic marker on a barbecue pit, Mark Pitt. And I added the zer, and there you were. And I go, this is spectacular. But the school on the north side of Chicago, I mean, who taught, I mean, was it DePaul or Northwestern? And he looked at me and he goes, the school on the north side of Chicago. What's the name of the school? He goes, there's a plant. There's a sticky plant that you give people. It's got thorns on it, and you give it to people, but it's a flower. Sometimes it's red. And I said, you're talking about like a rose, right? And he goes, rose. And he paused, and he turns to his wife, and he said, Rose, what's the name of that school I go to? Your brain is a pattern detector. It is constantly looking for usable patterns so you can predict the future, the next possible thing that's going to happen. Jokes take advantage of your pattern detection mechanism. A guy walks into a bar, and he sits down, and he turns to the bartender. He says, hey, can I get a whiskey? And the bartender says, and the punchline comes out of left field. It's true, it makes sense, but it's surprising. And events like this, circumstances like this, are intriguing to us. We love these, and that's why there's a big, shiny city on the Nevada desert. That's what keeps you glued to your TV set throughout March Madness. That's why you keep checking your phone to see who responded to your last Facebook post. And if it is better than you expected, that's why you jump out of your Birkenstocks when your team sticks the dismount or hits the three-pointer right at the buzzer. This is the power of maybe. The power of maybe. Maybe we're going to win. Maybe we're not. Maybe he's going to tweet. Maybe he's not. The power of maybe. But Wolfram Schultz, a neuroscientist that studies these circuits in the brain at University of Copenhagen, says it's not all, you know, fun and games. This is yet again another learning circuit, a very sophisticated learning circuit. Let me give you an example. I have a 2004 Ford Focus. It has 186,000 miles on it, and it starts about 40% of the time. I put my key into the ignition, it's like I'm going to Vegas, right? And if it starts, I buy everybody drinks. But more than just the excitement of, is it going to start? Or the joy if it does start. If it does start, my brain is constantly seeking information, causal information. Why did it start today and it didn't start yesterday? Is it, did I pump on the accelerator? Did I hear a click? Was that the fuel pump that clicked in? Or is it warmer somehow today than it was? It is a learning circuit, the power of maybe. As a teacher, how do you do this? Well, students are veterans of the classroom. So I certainly don't help them to create this spontaneity, this feel like it's off the cuff. You can't give detailed syllabi. You can't say, well, today's goal is this. I want to keep them engaged. In my office, on the wall, is a red box. And this red box, I try to take a look at as I'm turning to turn off the lights to go to class. It reminds me that the brain has multiple circuits that learn. So when I'm standing in front of the chalkboard, I need to remember to have a handful of good stories, lots of facts, some analogies, and some metaphors, and I want to present this with just the right amount of zeal. Not too little, not too much, but it seems like I'm presenting this gift, not a chore. And we're going to draw. I'm going to engage the basal ganglia. I'm going to engage your cerebellum. And what isn't obvious or what is new or what's ambiguous, we're going to turn into a concrete visual object, and we're going to draw that too. And finally, I want to encourage or cultivate this feeling of spontaneity. And if I can do that, if I can engage multiple learning circuits, maybe I can build this foundation of ideas and knowledge and elicit a lot of curiosity. And hopefully that will endure, like three golf balls on the moon. Thanks.